Rethinking Identity, Silvia CASSAMAGNAGHI, Italians by Chance or by Choice, the Complex Construction of Identity of the Italian-American Orphans Program.
I will focus my speech on some peculiar cases, but it's important to have a general introduction before. Italy, in this period between the end of the Second World War until the 60s, the end of 60s, when the Italian law about adoption changed deeply, it was considered a sort of reserve of children, because Italy was still a very poor country, and it met the demand of prospective adoptive parents looking for Caucasian children to adopt, as parents especially from the United States, for many different reasons. First of all, because they were looking for white young children, because there was a great offer, sorry if I use this sort of commercial terminology, but it was the same that was used in official documents, unfortunately, from Far East, for example. But if they were looking for white Caucasian children, Italy was the perfect answer to their request. Why to choose the inter-country adoption for Italian children? Well, first of all, because it was very complicated, the adoption process in Italy. And this process was involved with a lot of good intention. Give a better chance to these children that had very few opportunities in Italy. And then it was a very peculiar period as well. It was the Cold War age. So the orphan children became one of the main tools in the end of Italian political system to fight against communism, because to send Italian children to United States, it was another way to make the link between Italy and United States stronger. And it was also the fear that these poor children could be very easy target for communism in Italy. So the adoption of these poor children, these poor abandoned children, could be the solution for all this problem. I have to tell you briefly about the agency involved in this mission. Mainly two agencies were involved. The first one was the most important. It was the Catholic one, connected to the National Catholic Welfare Conference, and it started its action with international adoption immediately after the end of the Second World War in 1940-46. But just from the 1950, the Catholic Committee for Refugees, that was the domestic branch involved international adoption system, took the complete control in managing all the Catholic children, all the Catholic orphans from Europe, especially from Italy. And since that moment, it started the mass emigration of Italian children to the United States. Both of these organizations involved, the first one is the Catholic one, the second one is a lay one, and we talk about it very soon, had a domestic branch, of course, the Catholic Committee for Refugees in United States, and the another branch in Italy, the Catholic Relief Service, that find eligible children in Italy for the adoption in the United States, collect information about all these children, and prepare documents for inter-country adoption. The other agency involved, we have many other agencies, private ones, and many of them were involved in big scandals because they haven't got all the characteristics to manage the international situation. So the only two reliable ones were the National Catholic Welfare conference, and the other one was the International Social Service that started its orphan program just in 1955. It has as well an American branch that had the same, more or less the same characteristic of the Catholic Committee for Refugees, and the Italian branch that in Italy was strictly connected with the Italian Red Cross for a lot of political reason that, unfortunately. How to find the orphan, the suitable, the eligible orphans? Well, we have a lot of institutionalized children in Italy. In 1952, for example, we have more than 150,000 children in orphanages all over the country. But they could come also from very poor family, and there were a lot, a certain number also of reported case. For example, relatives living in the United States are asking for children of friends or relatives living in Italy in a bad situation. And they brought them to United States. So social worker visited every single child, visited the children in institution or in private home, and they assured themselves that these children could be suitable for the adoption. Every single children used to have his own dossier, his personal study case, where because the social worker explore the situation of these children to plan their future, to obtain relevant information about their past, to explain parents, if known, how was the international adoption system, the meaning of the international adoption. The parents of these children or the legal guardian had to sign to declare that they consent to the immigration of the child to United States and his or her subsequent adoption by suitable chosen parents. Seeing this act voluntary and with an informed responsible decision, the child was entrusted with the care and protection of the responsible institution till the legal adoption was completed in the United States. And the parents also declared they had realized without any reservation that after the legal adoption in the United States, adoptive parents would have assumed all rights and duties towards the child and that every personal contact with the child would cease. Unfortunately, especially at the beginning of this orphan program, at the beginning of 50 and at minimum till the beginning of 60s, the natural parents very often had very poor education and sort of deference for the authorities. That could be a priest or someone well-educated or simply someone coming from a big town. So it was certainly possible that, especially at the beginning of the program, someone signed this paper without really knowing what they are signed for. As I told you, every single child has his own case history with all the information about the condition in which he or she lived in Italy and with all the possible information about the family, if no. And the agency in the United States maintained the contact with the children till they left to United States. When a dossier about children was complete, the Italian agency executive assistant contacted the local agency in USA to find a suitable family for the child. If the local agency had a family for the child, the Italian agency was immediately informed and the couple asked for all necessary documentation. So we have another case study, a home study about the suitable parents. If all the documents were in order, it will ask future parents to support the cost of the whole operation, and so the procedure for adoption could be started. the paper you see here is the immigrant visa and alien registration. It was a real one. And many different agencies were involved to obtain this document. The Catholic Committee for Refugees or International Social Service American Branch, Immigration and Naturalization Service, Catholic Relief Service or International Social Service Italian branch, and United States Public Service. It was a very complicated procedure. Also because there was a very important advertising among the Italian communities in United States, we had a sort of unusual migratory chain, because most part of these adoptive parents in United States were of Italian ancestry. And in their application, they could ask for an Italian child. For example, this is preliminary information on sponsor of the Catholic Relief Service in United States. And in this part, I've erased all the sensitive information, but here, in this part, they asked for a female, or 2 or 3 years old, and they ask also for nationality, Italian, and they have a very strong preference for someone from Naples. That was the same region the mother was from, the prospective mother was from. And it makes sense, because it could be easier to manage the situation with a common background or with some similarity in general appearance of the child, if the child looks like the prospective parents. What happened to this child when they arrived to United States? Well, first of all, they had a similar background, because they had an abandonment by natural parents, voluntary or not, because the situation behind these stories could be very different. They all had a period of permanence in an institute in Italy. The common journey to United States, generally by a plane. Most part of them arrived in New York airport. And the new family they found in Italy, new habits to afford, and another language to learn, especially for older children. But every story is a special case. For these children, migration and adoption are absolutely the same experience. So they had to fight a very hard struggle to find their identity. I'm Italian, I'm American, I'm both, I'm an Italian-American, because sometimes they were adopted from Italian-American parents, but from another part of the country. So it could happen that a girl or a boy from the north of Italy can be adopted by a family in the United States that has deeply South origins. So which is the Italianity of this family? And this is the demonstration that in a certain case, when these people realize that they are asking who they really are, the ethnicity can be voluntary or symbolic, because to be Italian for them means also to look for their origins, for who they really are. Ethnicity represents their origin as well. I would like to illustrate you some peculiar cases, and this is a case I found in the International Social Service archives. This is just the beginning of the story of this we can't call here just with the initial or original name. An 8 years old years old girl adopted in Massachusetts, and she was from Trieste. So she was a grow up child. She has a memory of her past, and her story, it was quite common because she was born out of the wedlock and knowledge by her natural father. And this is what we can read on her personal file. Since the child entered the institution at the death of her mother, she has rarely seen her father, and she's quite indifferent to him. She was adopted by an Italian American family in Massachusetts in 1962. The father was Italian ancestry. The mother was originally from Yugoslavia. And when she arrived in the family, she desperately wanted to be accepted, not just from her new family, okay, from her family, but also by the whole American society. So the first thing that she wanted was to change her name. That was a quite uncommon thing because generally the adopted parents try to maintain a sort of identity also through the name, the original name. Perhaps sometimes they are Americanized it or they maintain the name, but she wanted to change it. And she wished to please her family in every way, and she wished also to learn English as soon as possible. So there was a complete rejection of their origins in order to become a part of the new family, a part of American society. But I don't know what happened to her, because I have just information till 1964, when she was 10 years old. This is an interesting story. This is an extraordinary man, that is John Pierre Campitelli. The original name was Piero Davi. He was born in 1963 in Turin. His mother was an unmarried girl from the south of Italy that was sent to have her child in Turin because the scandal, of course. And he was abandoned for adoption placement. And he was adopted by an Italian-American family in 1965. And he lived for a period in New York, then he moved all over the country and then back to Italy. John founded this extraordinary organization. Since he had a very good experience, also if he had a very good experience with his adoption process, because his family loved him and gave him a lot of opportunities that certainly he couldn't have had in Italy as an illegitimate child in the 60s. It was so important for him to discover his origins. It was a sort of necessity from him, and he started looking for his birth mother, his birth parents, and in 1991 he succeeded indeed. And to overcome the trauma and sublimate the pain, he decided to turn his experience into a positive action, so he created Italia Adoption. That is a mutual association for children adopted in the United States and biological parents who remain in Italy. And he has three important objectives. Tracing the over 3,700 orphans of the Italian diaspora, creating a register that collects the personal information of adopted and natural parents connected with database of DNA profiles, and documenting the stories of each of these emigrants against their will. This is another interesting story indeed. Mary B. Relotto, B stays for Barbara. Barbara, this is the original name. Again, the name is important to connect you with your origins. And she was adopted with her younger brother, and they have two different, in the same family. She was 2 years old, her brother was 6 months old when they left to be adopted in the United States, where they were from a very poor family, a married mother with a lot of children, a very, very sad story. But she accepted very well her condition. She was quite excited of being adopted. It wasn't the same for a brother, indeed, that was always upset of the whole situation. And in fact, it was an extremely fragile person who couldn't afford the pain of adoption itself. It signed all this lifelong, and he committed suicide at the end. Mary has this sort of online diary. Internet is a fantastic way to connect each other of this person. The online diary, this is on Facebook, is called Mia Famiglia Me Stessa, My Family, Myself. And she was able to find her bee mother, her bee father, and all her siblings here in Italy. And she keep this sort of online diary every time she comes to Italy. I interviewed her, and she told me this. I want to grasp Barbara, to know what Barbara might have been or what Barbara is. You know who you are when you know your biological family, secular ancestry, when you know who you might be. So this is why I'm here, to discover other parts of me. Time up. So many of these children could have the double citizenship as well. They are fighting to obtain their right to discover their origins, to obtain the dual citizenship. Because even if they don't know, most part of them don't know, these children had the right to obtain the Italian passport as well, even if they were naturalized American citizen when child. And so this is they want to discover another part of themselves.
I have two questions. The first one is about the origin of your research, the social work, because in that time, social work was built up in Italy by the United States under mm-hmm. the reconstruction program. So you had the social workers trained by the Americans, and there is a lot of literature sent by the United States to Italy.
Exactly.
To found, yep. And my first question is, where does UNSAS and ONARMO, the association you dealt with to find case records? And the second question is, could you use the real name? Because I saw name and faces in your presentation. Is it possible to use?
It's not possible, because this is a sensitive matter, of course, and without the permission of the specific person, I can't use. And it's not fair to use, because I don't know what happened to these children that now are in their 60s or 50s. So when I found this name in documents, I just use the initial or the name or a fantasy name or something. I'm using the real name when I know the person, and I have the permission from the person himself or herself. The other question is about the social workers training, and of course they use the American experience, because in the 40s and 50s, when this orphans program started also for Italy, they had a lot of experience in the United States. In fact, the director of Catholic program in Italy was an American priest, that it was Monsignor Landi, and so he had work in Brooklyn with Catholic charities, and he had a lot of experience. And then when International Social Service started his work in 1955, they had a lot of experience of international help to children, to emigrate children, to refugees, children, because everything started immediately after the Second World War, when there were a lot of displaced people all over Europe, and a lot of orphan children in need of help. And so this organization fought also to change the legislation for immigration here in the United States in order to help these children to emigrate. Starting from 50s, there were a certain number of non-quota visas for orphan children from Europe, for example.
I have a question for Sylvia. I mean, this program went on until 1967, mm-hmm. which seems very late because the economic conditions of Italy changed strongly in the 60s, beginning from the very beginning of the 60s. So how could it be considered a very poor town, a very poor country, when the economic situation was so changed, and how could this program go on for such a long time? I'm curious.
We have the bulge of the adoption at the beginning of 60s. Just before or immediately after the beginning of Italian boom, economic boom, but this happened. The program went on till 1967 because 1967 was the year in which the Italian laws about adoption changed in Italy. Till that moment, it was very difficult for Italian couples adopting Italian children because the Italian law was oriented more to the parents' situation, to the parents' interest than to children ones. So, for example, an 80 years old person could adopt a child, an infant as well, just to transmit him or her the money, the property that they had. It wasn't oriented till 1967. The Italian adoption law wasn't oriented to the child. I'm not sure. After the left the left party were involved in the government, it was just before the.
About 10 years ago, I was here, and I don't know if you know Solustio, A Fistful of Dollars. Yes, and of course John, I know John Campitelli. The movie kind of linked the fact that in America we had more money and we can pay. Yeah. For these orphans, whereas in Italy, you know, sometimes they would bring children here without the parents that had kind of dropped them off at the orphanage for 2 years while they got back on their feet, and then they realized that their children were given away.
Forever.
That has happened. I don't know if you have any statistics, but the point was that there's a negative side to this, right?
Yes, especially at the beginning of the program, you're talking about the Salustius movie that is about an adoption, a strange adoption happened at the beginning of 50s. And in that period, Catholic Church and private and not very straight organization had the monopoly of the international adoption. So Catholic organization asked for a sort of contribution, voluntary contribution for the adoption. Instead, we have a private agency that have huge fees for manage the situation. And there were no control. There was no control about the migration of these children. So a lot of things happened on the edge of legality. For example, everything changed in 1959 when we had this very big scandal, the so-called Giambalvo case. Peter Giambalvo was a New York attorney, as you can understand, it was of Italian origins, and it was discovered he was selling Italian children. He went to, it was from Sicily, he went especially to collect these children from orphanage or from very poor family as well, because in the countryside there were poor families with 10 or 12 children, and these social workers that were not real social workers, of course, it was just the beginning of it wasn't a program as well. It was just the beginning of this operation of exportation of children. They went to this family asking for the children, making a lot of promises to them. We will bring your children to the United States. A new family will pay for their education, and so that they will grow up wealthy. And as soon as they reach their mature age, they can call to join them in the United States. But most part of this. These things were not absolutely not true, because it was a closed adoption following the American law. So as soon as the legal process of adoption was concluded, Italian family, the origin family, couldn't have any more information about the children emigrated to United States against their will, sometimes against the real knowledge of their family.
Our next presenter is Simone Battiston. Looking back at the biweekly Nuovo Paese, 1974 to 1983, evaluating memories and identities.
So with this paper, I am evaluating, or trying to evaluate, memories and identities of a particular group of migrants, those who worked and volunteer for a left-leaning newspaper, or for newspapers in general. So the media outlet in question is the newspaper Nuovo Paese of the Australian chapter of FILEF, which is an acronym that stands for Italian Federation of Migrant Workers and Their Families. FILEF was established in Rome in 1967 and was and still is an organization engaged in welfare, assistance, education and training activities for Italian migrants and especially migrant workers and their families. Although in more recent times, a number of projects focus more on immigrants that live in Italy. So it started to switch from Italian migrants and their descent around the world to people that make Italy their new home, so immigrants. Formerly, FILEF is not associated with any political party or trade union. However, it enjoys the support of the left, as broadly defined. And from 1967 until 1991, he entertained a close relationship with the Italian Communist Party. So I've been examining past experiences of members of the editorial committees of Nuovo Paese, and in particular, editors and editors-in-chief during the Biweekly period from 1974 until 1983, which coincided approximately with the period when the newsroom and administration were housed in the FILEF office of Melbourne, Australia. In 1984, Nuovo Paese moved to Sydney and eventually to its current location, Adelaide, in 1989. And since 1984, Nuovo Paese has been issued on a monthly basis, and since 1986, in a magazine format. So these are the list of editors and editors-in-chief from 1974 until 1984. At times, the position was not listed. And here, just the front pages of the when it was biweekly, then turned into a monthly, then it became a monthly magazine. So, moved from a tabloid to a magazine format. The majority of interviewees that I have contacted over the last few years have been originally interviewed for a PhD project on the history and collective memory of FILEF, the Melbourne branch. So, the experience in Nuovo Paese was part of the narrated story, so it constituted an important aspect of their militant and migrant life. So I'm keen to understand how identity, and especially political identities, interact and adapt in migration, transnational, and mobility contexts, and how such identities form or reform, are maintained and expressed, but also contested and transform over time. I'm also keen to evaluate the role of memory, both individual and collective, in recalling editorial experiences, and by and large, past and present militant experiences. So for this reason, I have collected oral testimonies which allowed me to float in time, and borrow Alessandro Portelli's words here, between the present and the ever-changing past. And in my study, I found particularly valuable recollection of the so-called impegnati, a term once used by Lidio Bertelli to describe the politically active and better educated migrants who arrived from Italy to Australia in the course of the 1970s and brought with them the political and social experiences of contemporary Italy. Now, this categorization by Batelli is open to question, as Joseph Falevi rightly once argued, that not formally educated working class members of FILEF, and some of them were also members of the editorial committees, had the ability to organize themselves in a modern and sophisticated way. So in other words, there were many impegnati from many different backgrounds. But it's a term that has been at least useful at the beginning of the discourse here. So those who had arrived from Italy, on the other hand, had experienced the more recent political development, they were keen, or at least some of them, to regroup and reconnect in Australia with the local political scene, initially in communist networks. So Nuovo Paese provided a new setting for militancy to continue or kickstart once again in the new country. If we were to place Nuovo Paese in the print press map, it is considered as an alternative voice. Since 1974, it has provided progressive media platform for issues affecting Italian workers of all the more recent migration, but also brought issues such as poverty and human rights. Some scholars consider it to be the ideal heir of an earlier newspaper, Il Risveglio, of the pro-labor Italian Libera, Italia Libera, the movement founded by left-wing Italian anti-fascist emigres during the Second World War. But in reality, it is a success of a short-lived monthly tabloid called Il Nuovo Paese of the Lega Italo-Australiana. And the tabloid enjoyed some financial support from the Communist Party of Australia. And it aspired to be an independent and inter-class paper for the Italian-speaking community. So with an identical sounding name but to its predecessor, but without the L, Nuovo Paese was launched on May 1st, purposely, was launched on that particular day, May 1st of 1974. And it was one of the first major initiatives of the recently founded Melbourne branch of FILEF. Since the onset, the newspaper charged itself with the task to inform the local Italian-speaking proletariat of the social and political advances in Italy and elsewhere, but it also sought to educate its readers. The newspaper bore the attention grabbing bilingual subheading Learn to Recognize Your Rights, which is, you can't read it, but it's right there. So we published news items from L'Unità, The Guardian, and other left-wing newspapers and periodicals, and approximately one-fifth of its content was published in English, which was a share far higher than any other commercial Italian language newspaper at the time. So in terms of print runs and distribution of Paese, a limited circulation, during the Biweekly period, it published approximately 6,000 to 8,000 copies every fortnight, which was about a quarter of the copies sold by the more successful commercial newspapers in Italian. It had a unique distribution formula. Copies were chiefly purchased by sponsoring trade unions and distributed free of charge to the Italian-speaking members. This was not a unique formula, but it was a formula adopted by other newspapers in the past as well, but one that proved to be successful. But what made Nuovo Paese an alternative voice was perhaps the makeup of its editorial committees in Melbourne, Sydney, Adelaide, and Brisbane. And there were approximately 50 members, most of them volunteers. So we had representatives of old and recently arrived Italians, members of the so-called 1.5 generation, along with second-generation Italian Australians, Australians of different backgrounds, political and trade union affiliations, but also members that were representative of progressive church quarters, members from secondary and tertiary education sector, as well as state and federal politicians from the Australian Labor Party. So to a degree, the committees of Nuovo Paese mirrored the diversity found in the FILEF organization with a mix of communist, labor, and non-political affiliated members. However, editors and editors-in-chief of the Melbourne period were predominantly first generation of recent migration and communists. So initially, the single most important factor that turned the editorial project Nuovo Paese into reality in 1974 was the arrival from Italy of Ignazio Salemi. He was a trained journalist who worked for L'Unità and the monthly magazine Philip from Emigrazione. He also had past experience as radio host for the Italian Communist Party in Eastern Europe. So as soon as I arrived, around him gathered a new breed of young activists, mostly newcomers from Italy, and some of whom will later become editors of the Biweekly. He remained in Australia for approximately 3 years before finding himself at the center of a controversial dispute over his amnesty application. He overstayed his visa, sought to regularize his residency status under the terms of the 1976 amnesty, but he failed to secure permanent residency and he was deported in 1977. And he left the organization and the newspaper without a pivotal organizer. His deportation had a short and long-term consequences, which also resulted in the relocation of the newsroom from Melbourne to Sydney in 1984. By then, all of those who served as editors in Nuovo Paese had left. So I was curious about the trajectory of the editors. So the Melbourne period, arguably the most politicized in the history of the newspaper, represents a rich site for evaluating the trajectory of the different political identities that form the editorial office, and especially of the impegnati. Arguably all of them started their exposure to political activism in Italy. For example, I've got the list here. So Pierina Pirisi, she emigrated to Australia in 1970, age 20. She first developed a radical political awareness in the student movement in Italy around 1968, awareness which migration only strengthened. Umberto Martinego immigrated to Australia in 1973, age 27. He was an arts graduate from the Milan State University and took part in the student protests of 1968. In Australia, he joined the local Italian Communist Network. Stefano De Pieri, he was also politically active before emigrating, age 19, and he immigrated in 1974, but in the Italian Communist Youth Federation. He too joined the ranks of the Italian Communist Party in Australia. Ciro La Gioia had joined the far-left extra-parliamentary organization Lega dei Comunisti, which was a splinter group of Potere Operaio, before moving to Australia aged 27 in 1979. So in Nuovo Paese, in the broad left, the Italian editorial members were able to reconnect and maintain their political identity through the transnational dimension of their militancy. For instance, through trips to Italy, where some attended party schools or party congresses, or in Australia, through the periodic visits of high-ranking officials from the Italian Communist Party headquarters in Rome, and the recurrent celebration of anti-fascist and Italian communist traditions. And ample coverage of these activities was dedicated in Nuovo Paese. But their political identity was not just able to be expressed, maintained, and celebrated. It also mixed with other political traditions, most notably labor. So a process of transculturation and political cross-fertilization, not just cross-membership, appears to have taken place. And this is also evidenced in Nuovo Paese by the great deal of attention dedicated to Labour Party activities and the efforts made by the newspaper to support Labour candidates during elections. Nuovo Paese forged a solid link with the left wing of the Australian Labour Party, which was best represented in Melbourne by Giovanni Sgro, the Melbourne Philip secretary and member of the Victorian Parliament from 1979 until 1992. And he was also a member of the Nuovo Paese editorial committee. But if migrants ought to be viewed as transcultural as well as transnational subjects, as Francesco Riccati has recently reminded scholars in his latest book, Italians in Australia, the complexity and dynamics of imported politics and political mixing might be better understood and contextualized. And one example is the way in which former editors not engage but disengage with the newspaper and its political environment. This was not a secondary matter for a politically charged newspaper with close links with the trade unions and deep ties with political parties, both locally and internationally. For instance, John Berto, Stefano and Cira quit Nuovo Paese in a fashion that revealed to us the influence of political agendas, Cold War paranoia, ideological rigidities, but also personal political journeys. Joe Caputo, for instance, was Nuovo Paese founding editor and later editor-in-chief from 1974 until 1979. He was born in Carpino, Foggia, but emigrated to Brazil as a child before resettling with his family in Australia during the mid-teens following the 1964 coup d'etat. His political militancy began with the participation to the Vietnam War moratorium campaigns. He later joined the Communist Party of Australia and eventually the Italian Communist Party. In his workplace, he was appointed shop floor steward for the clothing trade union. He joined Philip in 1972 and 2 years later began his role as editor under the expert guidance of Ignazio Salemi. In 1976, he was appointed editor-in-chief, a position he held until 1979. In 1979, the Philip management accused Joe of making unauthorized contacts with the Melbourne Daily DH and to have passed on distorted and defamatory information about the organization and its secretary. He was suddenly expelled from the organization. Joe claimed to have been victim of political purges and internal political tensions and to have been unfairly ostracized. So while making sense of his past political past editorial role and broadly of his political militancy, Joe came to terms during the interview with his political trajectory, which saw in that incident a turning point. Then he quit not only Philip and Nuovo Paese, but also the communist parties that he was a militant of. Joe went at great length in explaining the limits and contradictions the communist organization carried within them, as well as his personal political journey that took him and others, like Stefano, who was editor of Nuovo Paese from 78 until 1980, to ultimately migrate into the labor movement and the labor party. Joe went on to become a local labor politician. Umberto Martinetto is another example. He was editor from 1976 to 1978, left the newspaper and parted company with Philip in the wake of the deportation of Salemi. Finding his role as editor incompatible with interference of political agendas from afar. When disagreements arose between him and Giuliano Paglietta, the brother of the more famous Giancarlo Paglietta, and Giuliano was the head of the immigration office in Rome of the Italian Communist Party. For Umberto too, the oral history testimony provided the opportunity to reflect on past and present politics. After his editorship in Nuovo Paese, he became the Melbourne correspondent for the Sydney-based newspaper La Fiamma, and made a successful career in the media sector. Ciro La Gioia had a short-lived but fulfilling experience as editor of Nuovo Paese from 1981 until 1982. For her, the newsroom was an exciting working environment, and the role of editor granted her the opportunity to get to know Australia and Australian society in a way that was rarely granted to newcomers. But one of her editorials, which was critical of the Vehicle Builders Union, VBU, for expressing racist remarks on national television against striking migrant workers, put her in collision course with the Philip Committee. She was reprimanded, put on quote-unquote trial, as she recalls it, and told to officially apologize to the VBU. Some accused her of being a spy. After that episode, she quit the newspaper and the organization. But she continued her militancy in other quarters. The progressive Australian cultural artistic scene, the feminist movement, the Aboriginal rights movement. These are only some by luminary examples of the political and migrant trajectories found among editorial members in Nuovo Paese. During the Biweekly period, Nuovo Paese performed a double function that was and still is emblematic of the migrant press, as outlined by Lorenzo Principe. That is to provide readers with an outlet that helps them to maintain contact with their culture and to help them to integrate into the host society as informing critical citizens. But if we wish to know more about the function of Italian newspapers abroad as social and political aggregators and disaggregators and their transnational and transcultural developments, then memories and identity of editors and editorial committee members become as important as editorial content and circulation data. Thank you.
Thanks, Simone. You know the question I'm about to give you about Vince Basile.
Yes.
You left him, he wasn't sort of prominent in your account. Do you want to say a bit about Vince's role in 1975 in the publication of the scurrilous article in The Age and how that, and did that come up much in the interviews you had with these people?
Oh, it is very much. So Vince Basile was a journalist with, was he with the Age as well? Yes. There was a famous incident called the Italian Communist Move-In incident when the, on a Saturday, which was the day when the newspaper had the largest circulation, it still has, I think, on Saturdays, published on a front page with in cubicle titles, Italians Communist Move-In, with a picture of Salome. And apparently that was, that exposed Salome and the organization to eventually anti-communist paranoia. And eventually the newsroom, there was an arson attack 2 weeks later. So they tried to burn down the offices of Nuovo Paese. So there were conservative quarters that were alarmed by the fact there was, you know, a trained journalist from Italy that within literally no time managed to put the Biweekly and started to get had a, you know, working connection with trade, a number of trade unions, initially just a handful of trade unions that by the mid-1980s were 30 of them. They express very critical views on the number of affairs within the community. I mean, there's a lot of rhetoric, but if you sort of read between the lines, you can see that sort of the need to have a sort of contra point from the other newspapers in circulation. So Vince Basile sort of set Salemi up, in a sense. And interestingly enough, in the interviews, that point, which was a low point in the organization, in the newspaper, because all of a sudden the title was greatly exaggerated. And in another article, I also mentioned there was a parallel, because this is about the time when the fall of Saigon was, I think, 2 weeks away. So it should have been sort of Vietnamese communist move in, but sort of they used that attention-grabbing title to put the attention spotlight on the local communists, grossly exaggerated on the figures, but putting Salemi very much in danger. So when then he applied for amnesty, there was a big, thick, you know, Asia file on him already. But some actually saw that as an opportunity, not just an opportunity to, oh, so we do have communists within our organizations and they do run, you know, a newspaper and then do run activities. So it was actually an opportunity to make the organization known and visible, even in given the fact that, you know, it exposed them to great dangers. Yes, this is what he says. Yes, he says that. But some of the ones that I interviewed actually saw them. Okay. Actually, the organization grew from them.
Allegedly, also supported Basile in exposing the so-called communist influence. And Scrow was intimately connected with Philev, as you've indicated.
Yes. Yes, so the Giovanni, he's, along with other sort of ethnic candidates of the Labour Party, was the chosen one to eventually be the broker. The so he was the right person in the right place at the right time, and anything that would have sort of hampered or, you know, his ascendancy in political terms, but. You know, you have to sort of, I think, bear in mind that it was a collective of people coming from different traditions. So, you know, and this post-68 type of migrants already politically charged and ready to throw themselves into the arena. So.
Our final presenter is Matteo Pretelli, and his paper is titled God and Country, World War II in Italian-American Catholic Parish in Providence, Rhode Island.
Thank you very much for being here. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Joe, for sharing this session. My paper today aims to analyze a microhistory case, namely the World War II experience of the Italian community of Silver Lake in Providence, Rhode Island. This case study is instrumental to me to talk about the military experience of Italian Americans in World War II, a topic that so far the scholarship has scantily taken into account. Today's analysis taps into a larger project I'm dealing with another Italian researcher, Francesco Fusi, from the University of Pisa, which is relating to the wider World War II experience of Allied servicemen of Italian ancestry, including so Italian Americans, Italian Canadians, Italian Australians, and Italian Brazilians. It is a topic that we are analyzing through a social and cultural perspective, and we do include a rich documentation, including archival, press, and oral sources. In comparison to other cases, is of course the Italian-American experience is the most relevant in terms of number of ethnic soldiers who participated to the conflict. Why is the case of Silver Lake so interesting to the discussion relating to the role of Italian-American servicemen in World War II? In World War time, Silver Lake in Providence was an overwhelming Italian neighborhood. Consequently, my analysis is on a very ethnically compact and homogeneous community. If you look at the map, the most famous Italian neighborhood in Providence is Federal Hill. Silver Lake is more or less a couple of miles away. The Italian settlement of Silver Lake was born from an early 20th century migration of Italians from Federal Hill, the nationally perceived Providence, Little Italy. Many dwellers in the neighborhood of Silver Lake were immigrants from South Lazio and Campania who felt soon the necessity to have their own church because they have to move to Federal Hill to attend the Sunday Mass. Consequently, the Scalabrinian fathers in 1907 built the San Bartolomeo Church in Silver Lake. This institution is pivotal in my paper because during the war, it became the community social reference for those who were serving in the armed forces and those left behind on the home front. The parish is also relevant because since 1923, he published the parochial bulletin La Campana di Silver Lake, the Bell of Silver Lake, that I could scrutinize entirely. So basically, this is my main source that makes the Silver case case point particularly original. Moreover, the bulletin's scope was to foster information about the parish and his activities in the neighborhood. Moreover, the bulletin had to preserve the historical memory of the church history for the future generations. The bulletin also meant to be a useful link between the pastor and the parishioners, and intended to unite local immigrants who had arrived in Silver Lake with different Italian regional backgrounds. Articles were usually published in Italian, with certain sections printed in English on behalf of the younger generations. Pivotal figure in the Silver Lake Catholic community was the Scalabrinian father Peter Goret. Unfortunately, I don't have a picture because I didn't find it. A native of Valle d'Aosta, the pastor led the church from 1922 to 1949, so he was the community spiritual figure during the wartime. Goret decided to publish in the bulletin letters that arrived to him by his parishioners who had been drafted to fight against the Axis forces. The letters and the bulletin itself are very rich sources that helped me to shed light on the small Italian community in wartime. Specifically, my sample counts on 295 letters that arrived from servicemen stationed in the United States and in all war theaters. This is a table that offers you an idea, a figure about from where the letters arrived. The majority were from the United States. Then we have the Asian and European theaters as the most relevant in terms on number. In the 1930s, the San Bartolomeo Church followed moods and behaviors of the American Catholic realm. In a phase of overall accelerated Americanization of the Italian communities, La Campana di Silver Lake stressed the prominence of American patriotism and denounced the Soviet atheist communism. Nazism was also heavily condemned because of the anti-Catholic discrimination in Germany. Conversely, Italian fascism was particularly appreciated, as was in many Little Italies across the United States. In Silver Lake, parishioners anticipated participated to the campaign on behalf of Italy's invasion of Ethiopia by donating money and gold rings, while the alleged genius of Mussolini was celebrated. The Italian dictator was also seen as champion of Catholicism, especially after the signature of 1929 Lateran Pact between Italy and the Holy See. La Campana di Silver Lake even described as worthy of consideration the campaign of Father Charles Coughlin, the nationally famous anti-Semitic Catholic priest and radio preacher. As soon as the United States entered war, the Silver Lake community acted in terms of full-fledged patriotism, and the San Bartholomew parishioners contributed with 1,300 men, of which 26 were killed in action. On the home front, the San Bartholomew Church operated as a sort of beacon to boost morale and to contribute to the war effort in practical terms. La Campana di Silver Lake informed the community about how to protect in the event of air raids, required a volunteer fireman, and indicated guidelines to properly support servicemen. In particular, parishioners were invited to regularly pray for soldiers overseas, to write them letters, to save as many resources as possible, and to buy war bonds. In addition, as many other Italian parishes across the country, the San Bartholomew Church undertook ritual patriotic ceremonies made up of blessings of the American flag and placing memorials that honored the servicemen. All in all, the church worked to encompass spiritually and practically fighters scattered in the world and their families. According to Grace Piccirilli Horton, daughter of Joseph Piccirilli, who was a serviceman who experienced the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor, during the war, the neighborhood of Silver Lake developed a very cohesive sense of unity, and mourning dropped on the entire community anytime someone was killed. In addition, in these years, the communities were somehow enlarged to even include Italian prisoners of war held in the United States, people who were allowed once in a while to visit the Italian community of Silver Lake from the nearby detention centers. Last but not least, after the occupation of Italy, the neighborhood participated in the collection of goods to ship to the starving Italian population. La Campana di Silver Lake constantly emphasized the values of patriotism embedded in the duty of citizenship, American citizenship. At the same time, it stressed the importance of being a member of the global Catholic community. Father Gore enthusiastically reminded the war contribute of Italian Americans, while La Campana di Silver Lake clearly stated, and I quote, "A true Catholic is a true patriot, as logical consequence of his faith and religious practices. He will be at the front facing death, or at home he will be doing his utmost to provide for the extraordinary needs of our national defenders." End of quote. However, the duty of patriotism did not stop the church to express criticism or opposition towards allied strategic choices that could affect the Christendom. Specifically, La Campana di Silver Lake harshly condemned the American decision to bomb Rome, described it as a sort of sacrilege against the mankind and offense to millions of Christians. Likewise, the bulletin thought of the bombing and destruction of the masterpiece Abbey of Monte Cassino as being an infamous decision that had destroyed centuries of Catholic history. More importantly, maybe, La Campana di Silver Lake became an incredible medium of the larger San Bartholomew community, especially because it published letters that soldiers sent to the pastor and their families, informing about their military life. Father Gore was the driver of his transnational community network. A soldier for Italy in World War II, Gore was aware of the psychological pressure on soldiers and their families. Consequently, he became a sort of confidant by printing in the bulletin the letters received. At the same time, he published, still in the bulletin, messages addressed directly to the servicemen to boost their morale. Given its informative nature, the bulletin made public biographical sketches is on those killed in action, wounded, taken as prisoners of war, or eventually promoted to upper military ranks. Servicemen received the bulletin via mail from their families and soon understood the importance of this medium. Consequently, in the letters, they began to pass information on not only on their personal welfare, but also informed the community about other soldiers from Silver Lake they could meet on the fronts. For example, stationed in the Pacific, Private Angelo D'Ercole wrote, and I quote, "The value of the parish is for us immeasurable. I thought we only received a few, we have enjoyed them. It's the only source from which we received news concerning us most. Through the paper, we know the location and welfare of our friends," end of quote. Another serviceman, Frank Sant'Agata, wrote in a letter how the bulletin was, and I quote, "the best way and only way we boys here can keep in touch with the progress and activities of our parish," end of quote. Indeed, for many Silver Lake servicemen, their Catholic faith was a way to keep connected to the native community. Generally, the majority of writers in the letters stressed how they were trying of being good Catholics despite the hardship of wartime. In this regard, soldiers wished to reassure the priest they regularly attended Sunday Mass and took the sacraments anytime the situation allowed his practices. For instance, Michael Pepe, stationed in Florida, regretted the fact he had to be away from home in Easter time, but wrote to Father Goret, and I quote, "I'm still being a good Catholic. I will never forget my religion," end of quote. Others stated their willingness to avoid alcohol and women. And in general, we can say that no question, religion was a sort of inspiration in troubled times, to the point some servicemen recounted about new expressions of religiosity at the front among people who had not been prior interested so much in religion. I think one may interpret these reiterated references to religiosity even how a way of social acceptance in their community, given the fact soldiers realized how letters were going public in the bulletin. For predominantly Catholic Italian American soldiers, the encountering with non-Catholic peers was a matter of reflection. The historian Thomas Bruschino reminds us how the US Army did not discriminate on the basis of religions. Indeed, from letters printed in La Campana di Silver Lake, one understands how the American authorities tried to accommodate religious necessities of all draftees through the presence of pastors and facilities, the allowance of religious services, and special food regulations, such as meat-free Fridays for Catholics. Reactions to a multi-religious environment were quite different. Some of Silver Lake servicemen appreciated kind of harmony promoted in the army and looked forward a post-war age marked by no religious and race divisions. Conversely, others did not like the religious promiscuity, especially with Jews. Overall, these experiences played against the backdrop of a neighborhood, Silver Lake, where people could have a few chances to meet, let's say, the other. For instance, born in 1947, above-mentioned Grace Piccirilli recounted to me how in her youth, in the 50s, in the neighborhood, every street had Italian names, relatives, and she only realized the existence of non-Italian and non-Catholic people when she got to go to the middle school. All in all, as for many other Italian Americans across the country, World War II meant for Silver Lake servicemen a taste of new world. While a few lamented their distance from their church, families, and Italian meals, many were happy to recount about places they had visited or experiences they had made, despite the fact the US censorship did not allow soldiers to indulge too much in particulars. Some expressed appreciation for the military life. For instance, in Florida, John De Cesare Jr. wrote, "The army life is wonderful. It's fuller of orders and regulations and is making a man out of me." Another guy, stationed in Boston, Angelo Palumbo, wrote in Italian this time, not in English, how military life was fantastic. He wrote in Italian, "Si mangia come un papa, mangiando la carne due volte al giorno, il venerdì si mangia il pesce, non manca niente, avendo burro, zucchero, carne. We eat like popes, eating meat twice a day. On Fridays we have seafood, anything is missing, since we have butter, sugar, meat, etc." Despite the beloved their hometown Providence, servicemen could even appreciate the warmer climate of the American South and sunny Florida, the beauty of Louisiana's cotton fields or the Irish green fields. Generally, Silver Lake servicemen show in their letters a certain interest for foreign cultures and countries. Some develop a good amount of mind openness to the other. A case in point is Sergeant Luis Franco, who described the African continent as being rather different against the backdrop of the decadent picture perpetuated by Hollywood movies. Rather, he wrote to have visited developing country and his happiness in making these experiences. He wrote, and I quote, "The small amount of knowledge one knows is never realized until one commences to travel. The educational value is inestimable and brings far better results than any book learning can produce," end of quote. Attention was given in particular to France, a country particularly appreciated because of the sizable number of churches and the culture embedded in Catholicism. Then, Italy was another special matter of interest that pushed some servicemen to discover the ancestral homeland, even to visit to their parents' hometowns, where, of course, they met relatives. That was a practice pretty much common for many Italian-American servicemen. Catholicism in Italy, of course, aroused curiosity to the point St. Peter in Rome was a tourist attraction for many servicemen. Letters by those stationed in Italy were particularly long and rich of details. For these servicemen, probably the American authorities reduced censorship in order to foster information in the Little Italy's on the Italian dramatic situation. The US government saw Italy as a minor threat and used the Italian-American servicemen to somehow reconnect with the Italian people. In the letters, soldiers described Italians as very good people, but a starving population in need. A population that had been mistreated and cheated by Mussolini and the fascists. So pretty much this image reiterated the general tendency in the US administration to consider Italians as victims of dictatorship and warfare rather than protagonists. So coming to some conclusions. On 18 November 1945, the San Bartolomeo Church in Silver Lake solemnly celebrated the war hand in a mass attended by hundreds of parishioners. An honor roll was consecrated and included all names of those from the neighborhood who had served in the military. During the event, led by John Pastore, that was from the neighborhood, John Pastore in 1946 was the new Rhode Island governor, the first one of Italian ancestry. During the event, the families of the 26 war victims were awarded a Memorial Golden State certificate. Among the Silver Lake boys who had survived the war, Dominic Mazzotta obtained a sort of national recognition for having apparently fired the last shot in Europe. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's what actually the Silver Lake Bulletin reported. Today, the story I try to recount is mostly forgotten. Relatives of Italian-American servicemen told me how the memory of the war is completely gone. Only some street names or plaques across the neighborhood remind the names of local distinguished soldiers. However, in general, the same Italianness, the same Italianità of the word is disappearing. Italians mostly relocated in the decades after the war, and roughly in the last 25 years, more or less, the neighborhood has become predominantly Latino. The same church of San Bartolomeo, still existing today but in another location, has today a multi-ethnic audience, multi-ethnic parishioners, and Italians are just a minority. Thank you very much.
I have a question about the stand of La Campana di Silver Lake about the alliance between the US and Soviet Union during World War II.
About what, I'm sorry?
The de facto alliance between Washington and Moscow, between the US and the Soviet Union during World War II. You mentioned that the bulletin sometime criticized some government decisions, such as the bombing of Monte Cassino.
Uh-huh.
So in view of the strong anti-communist stand of the bulletin, which was a Catholic publication, how did it assess, if it assessed, the strange bedfellows alliance between the US and the Soviet Union?
The answer is pretty easy. Completely neglected. We never mentioned anything about this alliance. We continued to stress the importance of anti-communism. If you read the bulletin from, I think from the 20s onwards, and still after the war, anti-communism is the most relevant feature of this narrative. We all know how the church played a major role, the American Catholic Church played a major role during the Cold War. It seems to me how the bulletin, the church in general, pretty much follow up this trend. They completely neglected the alliance. So that was probably another way to emphasize again patriotism. Sorry, I cannot answer.
Matteo, do you know if any of the young men from Silver Lake were put into that special program for Italians, the special intelligence program that they had for Italians who went over to help during the war?
So you're probably mentioning the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services.
Yeah.
In my research, no one was involved in that specific program. Many guys came from Connecticut. They were sent overseas, you know, to fight behind the enemy lines, the fascists. But as far as I know, no one. The majority of these people were from the U.S. Army. From the U.S. Army with a tiny minority of people enrolled in the U.S. Navy, but it seems like they were pretty much ordinary soldiers, not involved in special programs.
I'm just curious, Matteo, were there any reports of religious miracles during the war? maybe not within the parish, but elsewhere within the Catholic world?
As far as I do remember, no. We have some letters, pretty much fantastic, by soldiers who dream to hit back home in order to attend the Mass, the Sunday Mass, on San Bartolomeo Church, but no reference miracles at all. No, I don't think there is anything of that. Soldiers look like very concrete in their letters. The letters usually are very concise because the censorship did not allow too much to indulge in particulars. So they wanted to stress in particular, I'm fine, the friends from Silver Lake that I met are fine as well. That was a way to pass information. But probably they were not so interested in taking so much interest for these religious miracles.
Did they write in English, Italian, both, or when they did write in English or Italian?
The Silver Lake's servicemen predominantly wrote in English. And this is pretty understandable, just because these people were mostly born back in the 1920s in the US. So basically they were American citizens, born and raised in the United States, so pretty much American. So their first language was English. Somehow they intermit some Italian expressions, okay? So they say something like Mamma Mia or something like that. But predominantly they write in English, even because the father, Father Gore, was an Italian citizen. I don't know if he actually naturalized American, but he was particularly good in English. So this sort of communication was pretty much in English. But at the same time, we do have a few letters written in Italian, as the one who was talking about food. So that means probably there were people arrived more recently from Italy, so possibly their capacity in writing in English was not still that good, or they just preferred to express themselves in Italian because of, I don't know, Father Gore was Italian, so there was more intimacy rather than in Italian. I cannot tell you. But actually the majority were in English, absolutely.